want to talk to y'all about a funeral. Funerals are usually sad occasions, and I think God sets aside a funeral to be a culmination of the sadness. It's a time when you get to be around a lot of family. You have memories triggered. Everybody shares different stories. Most of the people that come through to the funeral home have at least one memory they'll share with the loved ones, and they will, sometimes the loved ones ain't thought about that in years. It'll kind of be a time of celebration, a time of mourning, and a lot of it depends on how tragic the death was. You know, if it's a quick death or a young person's death, it's a very tragic thing, and it seems like people mourn harder for that as a whole. But yet, when you have someone that you have loved your whole life, it seems, and you spent so many years with them, and now that loved one is not there with you anymore, you know, it is very devastating and very hard to get used to for those loved ones, because, you know, there's so many things that you have associated with that companionship. So many things that you're never going to be able to forget, because you didn't have that loved one for just a minute. You've had them for a while. You know, I think about, some folks that I've gotten to know pretty well that have lost a loved one, and it's always going to be a void in your life. Miss Judy lost Brother Carey, and you know, I never had an opportunity to get to know Brother Carey, and I'm sure we would have been a hoot together. You know, I'm sure that would have been great. I would have liked to know him, and from everything that I've heard about him and that Miss Judy shared with me, I'm sure he was a great individual, and I know that he's missed. It has to be. I've heard stories about Brother Sonny's wife, Miss Laura, passed away. And I'm sure that, you know, you've always going to have these memories that just, you know, it can't be filled. Even though God's blessed you with another. And, the mourning process, it'll hit you really, really hard. People say that time heals all wounds. It doesn't really. It makes it a little easier because as time goes on, you get older and you develop dementia or Alzheimer's and you stop remembering as much as you used to. You go on and, your memories, what was we talking about? That kind of thing, right? I guess it does heal in a way. There's a story I want to read y'all. It's out of Genesis 23, by the way. And Genesis 23 is about the death of Sarah. Now, Abraham and Sarah had been through a lot together. He had stood beside her through her barren years, which in that time was very, very hard to stand with a woman that couldn't give you a child. A lot of times they would consider them unclean and, do away with them and replace them with another. Apparently she was very attractive. I mean, even Pharaoh thought she was attractive when she was 65. He was like, she's hotter than most of the Egyptian chicks, so I would like her, He swiped right on her, Or maybe swipe left. I'm not sure which way you're supposed to swipe. I ain't ever swiped. I don't know. What is that? It's an app, I think. That you swipe left or right. Does anybody know?
It's a dating app.
It's a dating app?
Yeah.
Well, we didn't even have cell phones back when I started dating. So I know there wasn't no dating app back then. It was notes. There was a box you checked. That was about it. But anyway, so long before swiping was a thing. Pharaoh swiped on Sarah. And then there was another instance where another guy, what was his name? Uh, Abimelech, he, you know, wanted to swipe on Sarah also. She was a very nice looking lady. And God promised them that if you will follow me, not even if, he said, follow me, and I will make you your descendants numerous. So Abraham followed God, and Sarah was right there with him. They went through a lot together. They finally, after she come up with a plan for them to have a kid, she was like, I want you to have a son so bad, have one with my servant here, and I will consider him the heir. I will consider him your seed, and we'll let him be the blessing. And when her servant did get pregnant, she had to listen to her servant, you know, putting her down and belittling her and telling her, I could do something you couldn't. Abraham probably loves me more than he loves you and all this stuff. You can imagine what people did, what she said. So she had to put up with all that, but she stayed with Abraham through all that. After they finally had their kid, when she was around 90 years old, she gave birth to Isaac. And after he was about, I believe, 17 or so, God tells Abraham, take him up on the mountain and sacrifice him. So she had to watch Abraham take her only son off. And I'm sure that was hard. But she didn't, you know, like waver in her faithfulness to Abraham. She stuck with him. Well, here they are. She's 127 years old now. That's a full life, right? I mean, she lived longer than the sushi-eating folk. So she done lived to be 127 years old, and she died in Hebron. And then verse number 2, it says, she died in Hebron in the land of Canaan, and Abraham went to mourn for Sarah and to weep over her. Now, it's not sufficient enough to say that he was sad. The Bible tells us that he went to weep and mourn, okay? Now, this Jewish word for weep, I told y'all this once before. When the Jewish folks wept, it was uncontrollable crying. And it wasn't just one person that did it. They tried to outcry one another. And it was a full-on emotional heartbreak when they used the word weep. All right, they couldn't. I mean, it was the worst kind of cry you ever seen. How many of y'all have ever done this? You might not remember because it's normally children that do it. But you cry so hard that you don't breathe.
That's right.
I mean, I know that my kids. Which one of them would stop breathing? Was it Luke that would do it or Maggie? She would do it. Maggie got so mad one day, she held her breath and turned to flip. She was 18 months old. Jumped, turned to flip in the air and landed on her bottom. Now, that's a fit. She was brokenhearted. I'm sure it wasn't about nothing. But them kids, you had to blow in their face to try to get them to breathe again. I mean, they're eventually going to breathe, but they scared you. I've seen kids cry all of a sudden, their nose and their eyes start running, and this, that, and they'll have spit hanging down, and it's not regular spit, it's like a slinky, you know, hanging way down, and the wind blows, and it goes like that, and it's just, you can't control that, you can't stop it, you can't console it, their world is destroyed. Then you get older, and you learn that crying don't really help, so. Stop. But every now and then something breaks your heart and makes you cry like that.
That's right.
Abraham, he was having one of these cries. He wept, and when he wept, it was like when it said Jesus wept, it was a full-on heartbreak. There can't be nothing more sadder than that. When Jesus' friend Lazarus died, Jesus went to the grave. And for you that like to learn Bible verses, one of the easiest ones in the Bible is Jesus wept. And that speaks, I mean, it's so much more than just two words. It is a total gut-wrenching heartbreak.
Right.
And that's the same type of agony that I'm sure Jesus felt when he was in the garden, when he drank the cup that contained the wrath of our sins. When he realized exactly how it was going to feel to be separated from God. I'm sure that heartbreak was just so immense. If you have a hard time feeling heartbroken about anything like that, maybe your problem's not that you can't get emotional about stuff, but it's maybe that you don't love stuff. Abraham loved Sarah, and when she died, it broke his heart. Because not only did he weep, but he mourned for her. When people mourned back in that time, they would go to where the body was laid. Usually they laid it on like a bed or a mat, and you would get down at the feet of that individual, and you would get on your knees, and you would like put your head between their feet, and you would pray and cry and basically soak the feet of that person with your tears. That's what you would do. And some scholars think that what they were actually doing was a form of washing their feet with their own tears. Just like the woman that washed Jesus' feet with her hair and things like that. I believe it was kind of like that. You are so brokenhearted, you're crying so much, you're mourning so bad because you're going to miss him. So, that's what Abraham was doing. Now, in verse number 3, the scene changes a little bit. It says that Abraham rose from beside his dead wife and spoke to the Hittites. Now, it says that, this is what he says, I'm an alien and a stranger among you. I'm a sojourner, okay? I'm a foreigner. Sell me some property for a burial site here so I can bury my dead. He wanted to get her out of his sight. Now, when you get to a point of finally being able to let go, it's proper to have a burial, okay? Because it gives you some sense of finality as far as death is concerned and the body here on earth. At that point, there's no more looking at them. And I'll be honest with y'all, this is my own personal thing. I don't like to go to a casket and see a person's body. I like to remember them alive. Because the next time I see them and they talk to me, they're going to be alive. If they were a Christian. Alright? And if they're not a Christian, then that's one of the saddest sights you can see. Is a body laying there and their soul's already gone for an eternal punishment. Either way, I don't want to see it. I got to. Some kinfolk, they like to take pictures of them in the grave. That way they can remember the last image of them. And I'm always, you know, growing up, every time some of them would pass away, they'd go in there with the Polaroid. They'd come out shaking that thing. But this is so weird. What do they call it? Macabre? I always want to say macabre, but it's macabre. Anyway, it's weird. Now, when your loved one dies, ever how you need to deal with it, you deal with it. Some people say, don't make a real big deal about it, and they're like, cremation's fine with me, we'll save a grand. You know, and some people put it in their will, you must cremate me, don't be spending that money on no box. Some people do that. And other people's like, I got a policy, you better have me a nice casket. You know, I better go out in style and things like that. Ever what floats your boat, you just sell that thing right on. All right? It's okay. Your mourning process is your mourning process. All right? You do what you have to do to deal with this. Since we are Christians, since you all sat down at the end of singing, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. We are all Christians here. Since we're all Christians, the same thing that happens here to Abraham is going to apply to you at some point in your life.
Right.
Okay? Abraham said, I need to bury my wife. I want to bury her here. He didn't want to bury her anywhere else. This area right here in Hebron is in Canaan, and that's very close to the place where he first set up in Canaan with the trees, and it's a beautiful little valley there. So that's where he wanted to bury her at. Now listen to this. The Hittites said this back to Abraham, "Sir, listen to us. You are a mighty prince among us. Bury your dead in the choicest of tombs. None of us will refuse his tomb for burying the dead." Now, the way the land was set up back then, they had mountains and stuff around on each side of the valley. And those mountains were very cavernous. They had little nooks and crannies and stuff like that in it. So they didn't necessarily have to dig them out. They were already started, but they would go in there and doll them up a little bit. You know, dig them out some, make them suitable, put a little, few little table-like things, you know, to place the body on. And sometimes they'd fashion doors made out of rocks or wood and stuff like that. And usually your family's tomb was backed up to the end of your field, okay? So you live on one end, you farm it, and when you die, you wind up on the other end of it. That's the way it was set up. So he was looking for a place to lay his wife. He wasn't necessarily looking for, you know, a big plot of land or anything. He tells them, "I'm a sojourner. I'm just passing through. I'm not going to be here forever. I'm planning on living somewhere else. I just need a temporary place to store my wife because she's not going to stay here either." He was planning on, even though this is the promised land, okay, he was planning on the promised land being somewhere else. And that's what we as Christians believe, right? So since we believe this, the same thing that happens right here with Abraham, I believe is going to happen to us. It says, you pick your place, wherever you want to bury the dead. You just pick it. The best one, whatever it is. In verse 7, Abraham rose up and bowed down before the people. And he said to him, "If you're willing to let me bury my dead, then listen to me and intercede with Ephron, son of Zohar, on my behalf. So he will sell me the cave of Machpelah, which belongs to him and is at the end of his field. Ask him to sell it to me for the full price as a burial site among you." Now it says, Ephron the Hittite was sitting among his people, and he replied to Abraham in the hearing of all the Hittites who had come to the gate of his city. He said, "No, my lord, listen to me. I give you this field. I give you the cave that's in it. I give it to you in the presence of my people. Bury your dead." So he's trying to just give it to them. A whole field and the cave. That's a big present. Okay? That's a big gift. Again, Abraham bowed down before the people, and he said to Ephron in the hearing, "Listen to me. If you will, I will pay the price of the field. Accept it from me so I can bury my dead there." So he's insisted. Somebody's like, "Let me pay you for that." And you're like, no. "It's okay. You don't owe me anything." But you're like, "No, I insist." And then they're like, "Well, all right. You know, if you're going to keep going back and forth, you know, if I turn you down once, that's it. You insist again, I don't want to be rude. I'm going to take it. You know, let's not get in a fuss about it, right? Blessed are the peacemakers." Anyhow, so Ephron says this to Abraham. He says, "Listen to me, my lord. My land is worth 400 shekels of silver." That's like 10 pounds of silver. And he said, "But what is that between me and you?" I think the King James Version says, "What is that between ye and thee?" Or "me and thee." Something like that. He says, "Bury your dead." So Abraham agreed to Ephron's terms. And he weighed out for him the price he had named in the hearing of the Hittites, 400 shekels of silver, according to the weight current among the merchants. So Ephron's field in Machpelah near Mamre both the field and the cave in it, and all the trees within the borders of the field was deeded to Abraham as his property in the presence of the Hittites. So Abraham buried his wife, Sarah, in the cave, and the field and the cave in it were deeded to Abraham by the Hittites as a burial site. So I guess you could say things worked out. He got him a burial plot for his wife. That's pretty nice. You know, I've been around a lot of families that had to bury folk. And one of the first things they have to think about, I mean, you have to make arrangements, you know. And it's hard because that first decision, you got to figure out what funeral home you want the body sent to. And, you know, what funeral home you're going to use, because I think it's illegal to just do it at home. You know, you can't do it yourself, can you? Can you ride them on back to the truck and stuff? That's legal.
You put them in a box.
I didn't hear that. You hear that? You can do it yourself. We ain't got to embalm nothing. It's going to rot anyhow. Just throw me over the fence.
I'm not talking about burying them on your land, not putting them in a cemetery or anything like that.
But you know, he said within 24 hours.
You don't have to be embalmed if you don't want to be embalmed. You can leave that way.
See?
Yeah, you have to bury it within 24 hours.
Yeah, because we got a friend who's a mortician, and I always tell him I didn't want to be embalmed. And he said, you don't have to be.
Okay.
Yeah, within 24 hours.
So you ain't going to know.
No, you ain't going to know, but see, you can't be choice.
So Lou, if I die, you got 24 hours to build a box. And then we got some land down here in Coos County.
I think Sister
Eddie's
got one over there.
That's right. Does it? He's got a casket.
Yeah, that they use for Halloween decorations for years.
He'll probably let you have it.
Just if you need it within 24 hours.
So see, these arrangements are taken care of. We want Puff Daddy played at the funeral. I want gift bags handed out with them little blowing things. Right. It's going to be a party, celebration.
We need to wear hats.
If you want.
Which Puff Daddy
songs
are
we playing? I'll be missing you.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Puff the Magic Dragon. No, that's the old me. So we got it all planned out. We got it all planned out. Now, if I die, my wife ain't got a word with it. It's all taken care of. I mean, we have life insurance, and she'll probably do it different. But I will haunt her.
That's all right.
Nah, we don't haunt. Don't even start with that. Preacher said we haunt. No, we don't haunt. All right. Anyhow, when you have a death in the family, that is usually one of the first stresses. And if you don't have a cemetery plot somewhere, then you got to find one. And it's like such a big deal about where you're going to be buried at. You know, it's like, well, that's where I was born at, or that's where I live, or, you know, and this, that, the other, and I would like to be buried in that cemetery, and, you know, stuff like that. But that's just another stress. So now you got to hope that graveyard you finally picked has an opening, or that you can get in touch with whoever the director of the cemetery is, and, you know, it would be better to have these arrangements made ahead of time. It don't take very long. Just make them up. If you got youngins, make a will so they don't fuss. Just take care of it, and everything will be fine. But, you know, it's still going to be stressful because you got to say goodbye. Abraham was pretty tore up about it, and God put him in a place where he could be blessed. If he had stayed where he grew up, over in Ur, I'm sure they had a family cemetery and everything was fine. But he went and he followed God. And God provided for him a pretty place, a place to lay his wife. Now, I got to think about that. I had never thought about it like this. But you know, Ephron, that Hittite man, in Abraham's darkest moment, while he was burying his wife, he became a blessing to Ephron. This guy, I mean, we don't know if his land was up for sale. We don't know his financial status. Being a Hittite, it probably wasn't great. So, all of a sudden, he's done got 10 pounds of silver from a guy who got his money because Pharaoh just gave him a bunch of stuff when he left. Abimelech gave him a bunch of stuff when he left. And he kind of got this stuff because of his wife. So before God ever made anything, he knew where Abraham needed to be. And he made sure that Abraham was provided for in his darkest hour, and that Abraham was a blessing to somebody else in his darkest hour. So I think about us. We have the same God. We have the same deaths that go on in our lives. In your darkest hour, we know that God will provide for your needs. Whatever you need, God will provide for you. Right. If you need comfort, he will give it. Peace, absolutely. If you need financial help, I'm sure that God through his church will absolutely take care of anything that you need. But all too often, we miss out on how is this a blessing to anybody else. And it's because when we have this loss, we get so consumed with the loss that it just becomes a selfish thing. Now, I've said this for a long time, and a lot of people don't like to hear this, but a lot of times funerals are, and the way people act at funerals is the most selfish thing you'll ever see a Christian do.
Right.
Because they think that it's all about them. I grant you, you have lost a loved one, and your heart is broken, and you are mourning, but there are other people that are probably mourning also. And I've seen families compete to see who can be the most brokenhearted. Who can weep the loudest? You know, who's going to miss them the most? And it's just not appropriate. It's not honoring the dead. And it's sure not honoring God. Now, I'm not telling you you can't cry at your loved one's funeral. But let's remember what's really going on. God's in control of all things. Jesus got done with their place. He said he's going to prepare a place, right? So he got done with their place because he said, when I'm done preparing your place, I will come and get you. So Jesus prepared their place. He come and got them. Now they're living in their place that Jesus prepared for. That don't sound like something to cry about, does it?
I think we need to rejoice out there.
Yeah, absolutely.
I do. And cry. Somebody has a baby, you know.
Yeah,
bring that kind of backwards.
I get it though. Mm-hmm. Crying over a baby being born. Whew, what's this baby gonna be?
Yeah.
You know. I mean, Ted Bundy was a baby once, mm-hmm. And I'm sure he wasn't. He was probably cute when he was a baby. He didn't become cute when he got older. All these other bad people in the world, I mean, they were babies once. Full of promise. They went the wrong way. We should mourn over those folk. Because they're in hell. Anyway, the point was, for tonight, in your darkest hour, God will be there and provide for you. And he will also, in your darkest hour, use you to be a blessing to somebody else. I know, shout out to Black Betty, if she watches, something happens to Alicia, she'll probably be competing with me to see who's the saddest, you know, but I'm just going to wipe the floor with that chick, it's over, but she'll try, but that's all right, because I will also rejoice, and probably even hug her, probably, because, you know, she'll be sad too. Stop. Okay. That's all for tonight.